Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to the featured session on behalf of AnitaB.org. Our mission is to connect, inspire, and guide women in computing and organizations that view technology innovation as a strategic imperative. We envision a future where people who imagine and build technology mirror the people and societies for whom they build it. We are so excited this year to have Jennifer Rexford, Gordon Y.S. Wu, Professor of Engineering and the Chair of Computer Science at Princeton University here at GHC 2017. Jennifer Rexford is a professor in the School of Engineering and the Chair of Computer Science at Princeton. And before joining Princeton in 2005, she worked for 8 years at AT&T Labs in research. Jennifer received her BSc degree in electrical engineering from Princeton in 1991 and a PhD in electrical engineering and computer science from the University of Michigan in 1996. She served as the chair of ACM SIGCOM from 2003 to 2007. Jennifer was the 2004 winner of ACM's Grace Murray Hopper Award and the 2016 recipient of the ACM Athena Lecturer Award. She is an ACM Fellow and a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the Nation Academy of Engineering. Let's give a big round of applause for Jennifer Rexford and welcome her to the stage.
Thank you. Great, it's a pleasure to be here with all of you. For someone like myself working in computer networking, this is a really exciting time. The internet within our lifetimes has gone from being a research experiment in the lab to become a global communications infrastructure. And what's exciting about the internet is the constant change around it, change in the applications that run above it, the kinds of devices that connect to it, and the media that runs underneath it. And so as a result, the big challenge for the field of computer networking, but I would argue for computer science and IT more broadly, is to really design and operate computer networks that we can truly depend on. And that means a whole host of things. That means high performance, high reliability, good security, privacy, fairness, efficiency, cost effectiveness, and more. And I would argue that to do that, we need much stronger foundations than what we have now. Stronger intellectual foundations that allow us to build better real-world networks. And even as we have all of this constant change in the technologies above, alongside, and below the internet. And in particular, these problems are so challenging and the technology is so diverse and so quickly changing that it's really not something computer networking people can do alone. Instead, we really need to harness ideas and techniques from other parts of computer science and other parts of engineering more broadly. And so what I want to talk about in this talk is interdisciplinary research in computer networking. And I think of this as computer networking having a sort of big collection of interesting and hairy problems that are important, that if solved well can make the internet a better place. And they really need to be joined with effective hammers, if you will, techniques that come from sometimes from computer science and sometimes from other fields to be able to solve those problems in a rigorous and important way. So I got into this way of thinking about computer networking during the 8 years that I worked at AT&T after my PhD. And it was in a group there that did networking research, but I was talking quite frequently with the people at AT&T that designed and operated AT&T's part of the internet, AT&T's domestic internet backbone. And I also connected a lot with groups inside AT&T research that did algorithms, optimization, and statistics to help us better optimize the way the network operated, to collect and analyze measurement data from the network in scalable fashions, and to infer things about how the network was performing or to detect cyber attacks. And so I was often a bridge, if you will, between people with these disciplinary hammers and the network operators with these nails. And the person who ran the group I was in, Albert Greenberg, who's now at Microsoft, had a really nice way of thinking about this space. He basically said, well, the internet was not designed with network management in mind. It was really very much a grassroots, bottom-up design. But the people people at AT&T needed the ability to run the network in a rigorous way, to be able to sell reasonable services to their customers. And so he said, well, maybe we can add on top of the internet a sort of control loop, where we measure what's going on in the internet to learn the topology of the network, to know the offered traffic, the current routes being used, and that we use that to drive models that analyze the traffic or optimize the configuration of the routing, and then go full circle and actually change the way the network is operating in response. And in particular, we did this taking the existing network as a given. In other words, we would assume that equipment we would get from equipment vendors was something we couldn't change, but we would be able to work on top of it by adding this control loop, if you will, bolting it on after the fact. And I found this work incredibly rewarding. I mean, for the 8 years I worked there, I designed a lot of tools for network measurement, network management, network optimization that were deployed in AT&T's networks and used every day. But there was one thing I found very frustrating, and it was important to me when I left AT&T for Princeton, was that the constraint that we had to view the network as a given often made us pick solutions that were less elegant, less rigorous, less robust than I would have liked. It was pragmatic, but perhaps not as interesting as I would have liked. And when I came to Princeton, I was really interested in rethinking how would you design a network with management in mind from the beginning so that the network would have the properties we care about, not as an afterthought, but as part of their design process. And so I'm going to tell you about three different projects that I've worked on since I came to Princeton that try to attack this problem in three different ways, three different layers, with three different disciplinary connections. The first, higher level policies. We want our network administrators to be able to tell the network what to do using higher level languages rather than low level configuration interfaces. And for this, I connected with people in the programming languages research community who have a lot of experience in thinking about how to make it possible for people to express their ideas to computers. Level below that, I want a distributed collection of routers to do their own work in figuring out the right way to carry traffic efficiently over the network, rather than requiring the network administrators to fine-tune the configuration of the network. And so for this, I connected with colleagues in optimization theory that can help us think about ways to design distributed protocols that inherently solve optimization problems. And then finally, all of this hinges on having good data about how the network is behaving. And so in this work, I connected with people in theoretical computer science who work in an area called compact data structures to figure out ways that we could use emerging programmable switches to collect the better data about network traffic and network performance directly in the device themselves. So I'm going to walk through these three projects in chronological order, starting with the one in the middle. And what I'm going to do is tell you a little bit about the project and also about some of the technical and human lessons about doing interdisciplinary research. And then I'm going to end with a little bit of advice about how to conduct interdisciplinary research and when in your career it's an appropriate time to think about doing that kind of work. So this first project with my colleague Meng Chang at Princeton looked at the idea of distributed protocols, the messages that routers send to one another, as implicit solutions to optimization problems. And the lead student on this project, Jenny He, she's now at a startup company in the Bay Area. So when I was working at AT&T, the sort of approach we took to managing traffic over the network, the question we were trying to ask is, well, how much traffic should go over each path in the network to give the users the performance they need without congesting the network? And so typically, this is solved by three different parties operating in a very uncoordinated fashion. The network operator configuring the network, trying to coax it into picking the right solutions, the routers computing shortest paths based on that configuration, and the end hosts running what's called congestion control, where the operating system of the sender is automatically sending less or more as it observes its own performance over the network in order to avoid congesting the network and to ensure fairness. So these three different parties are each doing their role in trying to make the network determine the right amount of traffic to send over each path. But because it's done in this uncoordinated way, with congestion control, the end host, the computers on the edge, changing the traffic, they're changing the offered load that the network administrator is observing. And the network administrator is changing the routes in order to make that traffic fit on the right capacities in the network. And in turn, congestion control will adapt. So these two control loops, if you will, operating independently of one another, can lead to negative interactions where you don't get to the right solution. And in fact, the interaction can be quite slow. So the network can be quite inefficient for a period of time. And finally, it's also not particularly robust to the fact that we have different kinds of traffic on our network. We might have interactive applications like Skype that need low latency, and we might have high throughput applications like bulk data transfers. And those really have very different needs from the underlying network that are not captured by this simplistic traffic management model. So when we started working on this project, Meng and I took inspiration from a body of work that was just starting to happen in analyzing congestion control alone using optimization theory. And I'm going to walk you through a little bit of that background. So basically, for many years, since the late 80s, computers on the internet have adapted how much data they send by observing whether they experience loss or delay in the network, figuring that if they're experiencing bad performance, the network is congested and they should back off. And if they're experiencing good performance, they can afford to send more. And this sort of back and forth of observing one's own performance and sending more or less in response allows the distributed set of billions of computers on the internet to share resources fairly with one another without any central coordination. And that early work in the late 80s through the 90s was done without the benefit of much analytical support. It was a lot of intuition about exactly how aggressive to be in sending more traffic or how aggressive to be in sending less. And there's a nice body of work by Stephen Lowe, Frank Kelly, and others that started to look at this problem through the lens of optimization theory. And the basic idea was this, that you have a sender X sending traffic over one or more hops through the network, and the more they send, the more utility they get. In other words, there's sort of a happiness function, if you will. And typically we think of users being happy as a function of how much data they get delivered, so that's the x-axis here. And the y-axis is the degree of happiness or the utility. So it goes up, the more data you get to send, the happier you are, but with diminishing returns. You're the happiest when you go from zero to at least getting a little bit of data through, and you get sort of diminishing returns of how happy you might be as you get to send more. And so the idea, when you have multiple users sending traffic and overlapping on which links they send that traffic, you want to somehow maximize the total utility across all of the users that are sharing those resources, subject to the capacity constraint on the link. So the total traffic of these two users needs to stay below the link capacity. Now the question is, how much do we give to each of them? And so this utility function has a nice interpretation, because you basically give everybody a little bit of bandwidth before you start giving more to anyone else, because everybody benefits so much from that first increment of bandwidth that they get that it's natural to give everyone a little and then everyone a little more and so on. And so this utility function has a nice interpretation also in terms of fairness. By maximizing total utility, you end up sort of achieving some fairness objectives. And so there's a beautiful body of work that basically showed that this way of thinking about TCP actually matches with a lot of different variations of TCP congestion control, transmission control protocol that we've seen over the years. And they vary just in the shape of this utility function. Some are log X, some are X, and some are other functions as well. And it was possible to reverse engineer that the problem that TCP was solving was in fact this problem, that the links were observing their load, giving feedback in the form of loss of packets, and the senders are trying to send as much as they can, subject to the fact that they have to pay a price every time they lose a packet. So taking inspiration from that, we looked at our problem, where we have a little bit more flexibility. We now not only can decide what rate to send at, we can also decide which path to send over. So we started with the same utility function, but with that extra flexibility. So now routing itself is another variable. So now the X can be divided into one or more paths that each can send at a particular rate. So when we started looking at, well, what would happen if we tried to optimize utility under that framework, what we end up with is a nice decomposition, where each link is observing the load on its link and figuring out if it's above or near capacity, what the price should be, if you will, for using this link. If the link is heavily congested, the price should be higher. If it's lightly loaded, the price should be zero. And that those can go back to the sender, and the sender can solve a little local optimization problem to decide how to balance the trade-off between wanting to send more traffic to get higher utility or send less to avoid having to pay a higher price. And in fact, balancing that optimization problem can be done locally at every source. And so what's nice here is you end up with a solution where every sender, working only by itself, can solve a little optimization problem and decide what to do. And every link working completely by itself can compute the prices necessary to drive that distributed process. So we designed that protocol, and then we said, well, gee, different applications care about different performance goals, so their utility functions might be different. So we looked at, let's say, two classes of traffic, delay-sensitive or throughput-sensitive traffic, and we said, well, what if we had those two utility functions and every link could be divided into two shares, one share that goes to one class and one share that goes to the other, and we could have a goal of maximizing the sum of the two utility functions instead of trying to just solve for one of them. And so this same optimization decomposition technique can be applied here at two levels. One, to take this original problem and divide it into two problems that are solved independently, using exactly the techniques I just described a few minutes ago. And then another problem that's solved in a longer time scale to decide exactly which amount of each link's bandwidth to give to each of these two applications. And so we end up with a distributed protocol where each link is driving decisions made by each sender, and each link is deciding how to divide its share of bandwidth across those two different applications. So the lesson I took from this project was a technical lesson of the idea that kind of an obvious lesson in hindsight, that a protocol should be solving a well-stated problem. A lot of work in networking, we design protocols, but we never really sit down and write down the math, if you will, of exactly what problem are we hoping this protocol might solve for us. In this work, that's what we did. We started with a problem. We used a standard set of optimization techniques to decompose that problem into ways that we can really understand how it's going to behave in a distributed fashion, that it'll be optimal, that it will converge, and so on. Now, in reality, I showed this in a very simplistic way, showing you kind of the final answer we came to, not the process that we took to get there. And so there's some human lessons here, too. I sort of think of this as research as decomposition. So when Meng and I worked together, this is actually how the conversations went. I'd be like, hey, here's the technical problem I think the protocol needs to solve. And Meng would say back, this problem is too hard. Please change the network to make it easier. This was kind of an unbalanced collaboration, by the way. So Meng put it really well. He said, you know, if you're the professor and the student in a class, you write an easy exam, right? So instead of trying to make the optimization techniques we had to use richer and more complicated, we tried to make the network design induce the kinds of optimization problems that we know how to solve. And so I would come back and say, okay, here's a modification of the network that I think is practical, that I think can be done. And he would say, cool, now we can solve the problem. And so I'll give you two examples of where that came up in the work. One was that when we first designed the protocol, it did converge, it was optimal, but it took a long time to converge. And we've gradually realized that we could improve convergence by changing the objective function a bit to give a little bit of an early warning when the network was starting to be more congested, something that network operators often think of when they're solving their own problems on the network. And so that allowed us to redo the decomposition in a slightly new way to make the solution converge much more quickly. And the second example, we essentially, when we're thinking about the multi-class problem, originally we put all of the traffic onto a single queue and shared all the bandwidth amongst them. And what we found is it made the two different optimization objectives completely intertwined with one another, so we weren't able to tease them apart. And so there we made a fairly simple thing. Instead of having one queue that has both the red and green traffic, we had two different queues, one for each of the traffic classes, each with a certain share computed on some time scale between them. And that allowed the decomposition to be relatively easy between the two different classes of traffic. Now, of course, even this slide is a simplification. Meng and I weren't working alone. Our student Jenny was right in there in the thick of it with us. And so really another piece of getting this project to work was having the right graduate student who was comfortable with both topics, who could understand me and understand Meng even when we didn't understand each other. And so in practice, this picture really has another person in the middle that makes this kind of work happen. I think all the students in the room that know that's how the world really works. And finally, this project was done 10 years ago, but part of the reasons I want to talk about it now is one of the things we needed to make this work was greater programmability of the network devices. So even though we designed this protocol 10 years ago, it never really got used because the underlying network equipment wasn't able to support it. But that's rapidly changing. In fact, now programmable switches are quite common, and I'll talk more about that later in the talk. And so I'm actually ironically coming back to this work now because it is actually feasible to deploy it in practice. And I'm now actually finding a number of companies contacting me interested in trying this out on this new form of equipment because it's possible now to do this even though it wasn't before. So that's the first project. The second one popping up a level is, well, how do you let network administrators tell the network what they want it to do? And in this project, I work with people in the programming languages community on a project called Frenetic. Nate Foster, who's now at Cornell, was a postdoc in my group, and David Walker at Princeton, who's in programming languages. So here, the networking community made a funny shift around 8 to 10 years ago in thinking much more about centralization. That if we want to tell the network what to do, we should have a sort of central brain, a logically centralized controller, if you will, for your data center or my backbone or your enterprise. And then instead of designing protocols, we should be designing apps that run on top of this central controller. And so that's the context this work takes place in, which is a field called software-defined networking, which has really taken the networking industry by storm over the past 5 to 8 years. So you want to design some sort of application for your network, and you have this central controller. It gives you network-wide visibility, all the measurement data from the devices coming up, and it gives you network-wide control because you can tell those individual devices what to do. And to be able to do that control, there's a direct interface, an open interface, and this is the important innovation here, is an open interface between the controller platform and the underlying switches. So a group of us about 10 years ago designed this protocol called OpenFlow that, like the name would suggest, is an open interface for software to tell the underlying hardware what to do. This is not rocket science. In other areas of computer science, open APIs have been common for a long time. But in networking, as my experiences at AT&T earlier suggested, often only the vendor is actually able to write the software that tells the hardware what to do. OpenFlow changed that. So I'll just tell you a little bit about OpenFlow. It's a very simple idea that basically all that these network devices do is they're very fast packet processors. Packets come in, packets go out, and for every packet, you have to decide what to do with it. You're gonna drop it, you're gonna forward it, you're gonna maybe mark it or modify its contents in some way, and that's done on a basis of a set of rules that are installed in the switch. So each rule has a pattern that determines which packets match it, like matching on some portion of the source address or the destination address. It has an action that determines what you're going to do for packets that match that rule. You have a priority, so that if a packet matches more than one pattern, you do the action associated with the highest priority rule that matches, and some simple counters that keep track of how much traffic has matched the rule. So a packet comes in, you check all the matches, you use the highest priority match, and you send the packets back out. And this goes very well with a particular kind of memory called ternary content addressable memory that's common in switches that can do a parallel lookup across a bunch of rules at the same time. So this nice little API generalizes a lot of marketing terms we have in networking. Switch, router, firewall, network address translator, load balancer can all be expressed in different ways just by which bits in the packet you choose to match on and what kind of actions you take. And that really opened up the floodgates of people coming up with new applications they want to do on their network that weren't possible before. So we became really interested in how are people going to write these applications. The OpenFlow interface is all well and good, but it's not a linguistic formalism. It's itself a low-level protocol that's preoccupied with bit masks and priorities and low-level mechanisms for adding and deleting rules. So something you wouldn't want a programmer to have to deal with. So we wanted to have some higher-level abstractions that would let people program their network without having to worry about those gory details of OpenFlow. So we really wanted to find good programming abstractions. So, for example, if you wanted to write a networking application that did routing, monitoring of the traffic, firewalling to block unwanted traffic, and maybe load balancing for a popular web server that has multiple replicas running, you wouldn't want to write that as one big monolithic application because it'd be very hard to test, debug, reuse, port, and so on. And so instead, you'd really like it to be modular, right? That would be sort of a motherhood and apple pie in computer science. We solve all problems by modularity. But we have a tricky problem here because these applications actually need to work together because they're each, in some small way, determining how the traffic should be handled. It's not that you want to monitor some traffic and route the rest. You want to monitor traffic by source of IP address, route it by destination IP address, drop it or not drop it based on a bunch of other fields. So the same packets need to be subjected to all of these applications, and yet we still want them to be written in a modular way, and somehow share a single table of rules down below when it comes down to actually implementing the mechanisms for each of these applications. So the abstraction that we came up with is a simple one, that what a switch is doing, what OpenFlow is doing, is taking a packet and its location, a located packet, if you will, a packet with its header fields and its current switch and port number, and it's applying a function to it that will produce a set of located packets. It might be zero, an empty set, if the packet's dropped. It might be a single packet at a different physical location if the packet is forwarded. It might even have multiple locations if it's being so-called multicast to multiple receivers. And it might be modified as well. So the simple idea that you want to have a function from a packet to a set of located packets allows us to now define policy in terms of Boolean matches, like, you know, dest IP of a particular value and so on, and decide what modifications to the packet should be done. So that simple idea of viewing policy as a function is really nice for being able to abstract some of the gory details of OpenFlow, and it also opens the gate to being able to do composition of these functions to develop modular applications. So, for example, suppose I want to monitor traffic by who's sending it, and I want to route based on who's receiving it. You could think of this as a form of parallel composition. It's almost as if I have two copies of every packet, one that gets monitored and the other that gets routed, and in the end, I want to take an action on the packet that represents the collective actions of both. So a really simple example, imagine the function I have for monitoring is just for every source IP address keeping a track of a counter of the number of packets or bytes that have matched that. And for routing, I might want to say for every destination, I might want to forward out a particular output port, port 1 or port 2 and so on, depending on where the destination of the traffic might be. All the parallel composition does is to say do both. Now, in the end, we have a very limited computational model below us, this single table of rules. So in practice, we have to sort of synthesize under the hood a sort of a cross product, if you will, of these two policies. This is gory and disgusting, and you would never want the programmer to have to do this. So our compiler does this for them. So now, based on what source and destination, we're both counting and forwarding the traffic. But for the programmer, they can write the monitoring application and the routing application completely independently, and in fact, can maybe buy one from a third party and develop the other locally. Now, parallel composition is sort of fine for monitoring applications, but a lot of applications actually want to do multiple operations that modify a packet's header fields or location. And a good example that's common in a lot of data centers is load balancing. So you have multiple copies of a website because you have a huge amount of traffic and you also want to be more reliable in the face of failures. So when packets come in, they're destined to a single IP address that represents the website, but on the back end, there's actually multiple machines with different addresses that have to be reached over different paths that will actually carry the traffic. And so the application you could imagine writing here is load balancing. You're going to pick which server that you want to go to. And then routing. You want to pick how to get there. And the routing shouldn't have to know about the load balancing decision, and the load balancing decision shouldn't have to know about the routing. So here, too, you could imagine, I want to divide half of the users to go to one of the copies of the server, let's say if its source IP address starts with 0, or the other server if its source IP address starts with 1. And I want, separately from that, once the destination has been picked, to decide which output port on the switch to send the traffic to actually route the traffic. And again, here you can imagine a sort of synthesis of a lower level set of rules that will decide where the packet should go, and as if the packet had already been told where to go, how to get there. So essentially taking two steps and smooshing them together into one rule table in the underlying switch. And those are just two examples of this basic idea of parallel and sequential composition of policy functions, a very powerful way to build sophisticated applications out of smaller building blocks and to reason about them more precisely. So I think the technical lessons here were first this open flow standard that was developed by a large group of us about 10 years ago. Even though I've been kind of criticizing it as sort of a low-level formalism, it was really critical to enabling any of this kind of work to happen at all. And also, it was simple enough that it was possible for me to explain this to people in other research communities. Normally, when I talk to people outside of networking, they're just immediately overwhelmed with, you know, the sort of acronyms and constraints and artifacts of our field, and it becomes very difficult to engage in meaningful interdisciplinary research. But because the standard was fairly simple and reflected a lot of different applications in networking pretty naturally, it was easy to explain this to people with the kind of expertise I needed to be able to come up, for us to be able to come up with the abstractions we ultimately wanted. The second was that thinking in this compositional way, which the programming languages people do as their motherhood in apple pie, made it possible for us to design these simple, reusable building blocks. And in fact, my colleagues did a follow-up work called Netcat that's a really lovely piece of work that connects all of these functions and the composition operators to an existing mathematical structure called a Kleene algebra with test that is used in the programming languages community. And in fact, it ends up that a lot of problems in networking map very naturally into this mathematical construct, and it's enabled a whole rich body of work by us and by others because of this connection being made to this kind of core concept in programming languages. And finally, I'm not going to talk about it here, but we also fleshed out the other pieces of the control loop for a software-defined network, how to express measurement and how to do updates to a distributed collection of switches. So for me, this project came full circle to the kind of problems I grappled with at AT&T but could never fully nail because of our inability to change the equipment, and now made it possible to both raise the level of abstraction and have cleaner and more elegant solutions to those problems. The human lesson here, I think of it about embedding people. Nate Foster, who was a postdoc in my group at the time, now a professor at Cornell, he spent a year in my group, basically embedded with the students in my group who do computer networking. He became very, very knowledgeable about computer networking. It was a year spent learning and getting some preliminary work done. Not a lot of papers came out of that first year, but once he understood both fields really well, he was able to produce an immensely creative body of work. And the way we did that work was very bottom-up. We tried taking the technology available at the time, writing a bunch of applications, experiencing the pain of not being able to do that in an elegant way, and essentially generalizing from the things that were painful to figure out what abstractions would have made them less painful. So it was a lot of learning by doing. And then finally we did a lot of work, and particularly Nate, but all of us as well, in recruiting others. We really wanted both communities to appreciate this body of work. And there's definitely a learning curve we came up. And so we spent a lot of time creating tutorials, summer schools, survey papers. Both of us gave talks at each other's conferences. I gave a keynote at the main programming languages conference. Programming languages people gave talks at networking conferences. So we did extensive recruiting, if you will, to try to draw people into this broader field. And now it's a very vibrant part of both the networking and the programming languages communities. You'll see whole sessions on programming languages at networking conferences and vice versa at programming languages conferences. And then finally, we still found OpenFlow to be kind of annoying in many ways. It was very limited. There are many things we couldn't do because of OpenFlow. And that led us to think, hey, these language constructs we've been coming up with, maybe they could be reused to think about how to design the underlying hardware in the switch better so that the switches themselves could be more richly programmable and support these policies more directly. And so that's what I'm going to talk about in the third part of the talk, which is more recent work. So it's going to talk a little bit more narrowly about one specific technical problem. And this is joint work with Muthu Muthukrishnan at Rutgers, who's an expert in what are called compact data structures. And the student who worked on this project, Viva Sivaraman, she was an undergraduate, actually a junior when she worked on this project. She's now a PhD student at MIT. So in this work, we're really interested in thinking, well, how can we collect from the network the data we actually want? And we started with these new programmable devices that I was mentioning at the end of the previous part of the talk. And what these new devices do that support a language called P4, Programming Protocol Independent Packet Processors, it's a new language that myself and Nick McEwen at Stanford started out a consortium for, p4.org, if you're interested in learning more. So what these switches do is first they have a programmable parser. You don't have to decide ahead of time what the packet's going to look like. You can tell the switch what to expect and which fields in the packet you actually want to extract. And then the packet's header fields that you've extracted can be go through a stage of multiple stages of match action tables, where you might have also additional storage where you can keep information across successive packets to do more sophisticated computation. So you have arithmetic logic units, registers, and programmable actions in addition to the ability to match on the fields in the packet header. So think of it as sort of a generalization of OpenFlow, where now you get to tell the hardware what actions to perform rather than being given a set of them in advance. And then you have the ability to pass state from one stage to the next to split complicated computations over multiple stages, each with a certain amount of memory and a certain amount of processing capacity. Now, to be clear, this is still a very limited computational model. It's sort of a feed-forward pipeline of arithmetic logic units and, you know, some number of tens of megabits of data. It's not as flexible as a commodity CPU, but it can operate at terabit per second speeds handling packets. So it's sort of a sweet spot between the need to handle packets at very, very high speeds, and with often a nanosecond or two between successive packets, and the ability to do some reasonable amount of programming on how those packets get handled. So that opens up the possibility to a whole area of doing traffic analytics directly in the switch, instead of collecting data and analyzing it off-board, to actually put the analysis directly in the switch using those limited capabilities the switch has. And there's a rich theory literature in computer science on what are called sketches or compact data structures or streaming algorithms that we wanted to draw on. And so there are a whole bunch of different problems that can fall into this space. We picked one of the most popular ones, which is the heavy hitter problem. You've got tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of different conversations going through your switch. You want to find the small handful that are responsible for the vast majority of the traffic, the so-called heavy hitters. But you can't afford to keep state in proportion to the number of conversations. There might be 100,000 conversations, but only 10 or 100 of them that are actually big enough for you to care. You want to keep state in proportion to that 10 or 100, not in proportion to the 100,000. And that's sort of the technical challenge. So I mentioned before, this computational model is nice but constrained. We can only work in this sort of feed-forward model. We can't afford to recirculate packets or state back across the pipeline. So we have to have algorithms that can work piecemeal as they move forward. The amount of memory we have is quite limited, so we can't keep state for every conversation. We can only do fairly limited arithmetic operations, sums, basic comparisons, no division, no recursion, anything like that, and a small amount of metadata. So the problem we're solving, as I mentioned, is heavy hitter detection. We want to find the largest of the traffic flows or all traffic exceeding a threshold. And so if you look at the theory literature, there's sort of a nice, simple, elegant algorithm for this that is completely not suitable for the hardware that we have, but we sort of use that as a starting point. So I'll just talk about it briefly. So the basic idea is you keep a table with a key that, let's say, that indicates what conversation this is, and a value that says how many bytes or packets you've seen for this conversation. So if a packet comes in for that key, you can just increment the counter. But when the table is full and you have a new key, you have to evict somebody to be able to make room for the new key. And so the way that this algorithm works, sort of natural, it takes, when you have a new key that isn't already in the table, you go through and find the minimum count in the table and evict it. So here, for example, the key 5 that only has one packet or one byte of data would be evicted to make room for the new key. So this just isn't possible for our purposes because it requires a sort of order n, if you will, scan of the table to find the current minimum value. So that just isn't going to work. So we started to use this as a jumping off point. So let's suppose instead of going through all of the entries in the table, we just went through a small number of the entries and evicted the smallest of those, like let's say 2 of them. Simple idea, very appealing. So here what you would do is you would actually take 2 hashes of the key, go to 2 locations in the memory, see which of the 2 is smallest, and evict that one. So in this case, you would evict this key that has a count of 2. It's not the true minimum in the table, but it's reasonably small, and hopefully you can still do a pretty good job evicting a near minimum even rather than the real one. But this still requires multiple actions on the same table, multiple memory accesses. So you can go one step further and extend that idea by splitting the table in half and doing the operations once each on the 2 halves of the table, or more generally on D stages if you want to have D greater than 2. So a new key comes in. You say, oh, look, this is the, I'm going to compare it to whatever I hash into in the first table and say, OK, I'll evict this guy and make room for key 7. But you can't go back to the first table later. once you found the true minimum. Later on, when you look in the second table, you'll know, this is the thing I actually want to evict. But you don't know that information yet. So you unfortunately can't go through the tables once to figure out the minimum and a second time to do the evictions. We have to do the evictions as we go. And so that's the final step that makes the algorithm come together, which is to compute the minimum in an incremental fashion and evict the entries as you go along. So it works roughly like this. A packet comes in, you hash, you find an entry that has a value of 10, you're going to evict it. Gee, that's a really bad decision because that's actually not a very small number. But you'll figure out later that there's an opportunity to let that entry evict something else down the road. So we put the new key in, we carry using metadata to the next stage, this count and key, and it has an opportunity to evict the next entry because it's actually a larger number than the entry that it matches into. And so finally, you are still able, working only in a feed-forward fashion, only with one read and write per stage, to get the large flows to be in the table and the small flows to be disproportionately evicted. Okay, so that's the basic idea. We built a prototype of this in this P4 language that I mentioned, and essentially it works by using some of the features that I mentioned. It uses the registers in every stage. It uses an action that computes a hash on fields in the packet header to index those registers. It uses a simple amount of arithmetic to compute sums and minimums, and it uses a certain amount of metadata to carry information from one stage to the next. So a very good fit in the end to the specifics of the hardware we have. And in fact, now we're starting to work with AT&T on trying out some of these ideas in AT&T's network, which is fun for me because it goes full circle back to my employer of many years ago. So in this work, I think the couple of technical lessons, one was that we started very concrete. I do think this is a rich and broad problem space that we're just starting to touch the surface of, but we did so by starting with a very concrete computational model with our hands tied behind our back as much as we felt we could, with a single example problem that has a rich theory literature already and a straw man solution from that literature that it solves the problem very, very well with good provable results but doesn't fit our computational model, and then iteratively relax the straw man solution. And in fact, the work proceeded much in the way that the last few minutes of the talk has, in realizing something we can't do, trying to approximate it, and then continuing to approximate the approximation. And then finally, we've been trying, and this is sort of ongoing work now, to actually prove something about the algorithm we end up with. And we can make some theoretical statements about it, but they're not as precise as we'd like, so that's still something we're working on. And we're also trying to generalize this computational model to understand what other problems we might be able to solve efficiently on this computational model, and how in general to think about generating these algorithms, rather than having to go through a sort of a year-long research process that we did for this particular example. The human lesson there was really in engaging, again, a person who's an expert in one field with people who know the hardware constraints and the applications of interest, and again, a student who was really willing to go the extra mile in communicating with both. So in the last few minutes of the talk, I just want to reflect a little more broadly on interdisciplinary research. Now, for the first half hour of the talk, you probably come away thinking I'm a fan, and it's true that I am, but it's not always the right thing to do, and it has to be done in a right way to be successful. So I wanted to give a few, you know, sort of hard-won lessons from projects of mine that were not successful in terms of interdisciplinary work on what some of the challenges and pitfalls might be. So the first is, you know, I think I just want to stress that doing interdisciplinary work is a blast. I mean, it's so much fun. It's really intellectually interesting. You learn about other areas. You learn about your own area much better because you have to explain it to someone who doesn't share all of the assumptions and domain knowledge that you do. So it really causes you to actually sharply understand your own area, which is a lot of fun. And you get to learn to think in new ways. And in some cases, you know, real problems are inherently interdisciplinary, so there's a much greater opportunity for practical impact and intellectual impact on each of the two fields that are brought together. And finally, I just say it's actually socially a lot of fun. I mean, I think a lot of professors, I myself, my first 2 years at Princeton, really miss the close camaraderie that one has at an industrial research lab, the camaraderie with one's own peers, because faculty kind of run their own little companies, if you will, inside the university. But when you're doing interdisciplinary work, you end up knowing your faculty colleagues extremely well, because you really can't rely solely on a student to help you in executing the work. You often have to dig in yourself to understand the combination of the two disciplines, and that's just a ton of fun. So what about the risks, though? So one question is, you know, how many hammers should one have? So in the work I've done, I've been fairly opportunistic. I've worked with people in, you know, the three areas I mentioned: programming languages, optimization theory, and compact data structures. I've also worked in theoretical crypto and a bunch of other areas as well. But I'm not an expert in any of them. And that's sometimes better, particularly for someone earlier in their career, to master one hammer on their own rather than to be so reliant on their collaborators. I mean, I've tended to be extremely reliant on my collaborators to fill in the gaps that I lack. And that can certainly be more challenging for someone at a junior stage in their career. So there's sort of two options here, I think, and they're both possible. One is to pick one hammer that you master along with your own domain. And that can be a really great adventure for grad school or even, like in my colleague Nate Foster's case, a postdoc. Of course, you want to pick that hammer wisely because you want it to be reusable for many different research problems across your career to sort of amortize, if you will, the overhead of learning the other field well. The other model of what I've done, of working by collaboration, can be riskier, but there is a way to make that kind of work deep as well if you really dig in and know your own field well enough to be able to articulate carefully, precisely, important technical problems that, if solved well, will have a huge amount of impact. And that requires a fair amount of depth in one's own field. And so I've taken that approach that can work. It just means you have to pick your nails very wisely and have a lot of depth of knowledge and experience within your own field. Second, is related to the first, is that there can be a bit of a steeper learning curve. Projects take longer to launch. That was certainly true in the programming languages project I mentioned, where Nate spent a whole year basically learning before really creating anything novel. You have to learn not only the technical details of both fields, but also interesting differences in research culture that are sometimes not articulated very well. And in fact, in some cases, it can be easier to start with the hammer and not the nail. To take Nate as an example, coming in from programming languages, it was easier for him to learn some networking, particularly through the lens of OpenFlow and with a lot of background in my group, than it might have been for one of my students to get many years of training in programming languages. Programming languages is a field, I think, that has a lot more nesting of concepts and training before you can really do novel work. And so it may be easier to come from that knowledge to networking than the other way around. And finally, it's sometimes possible to join a community that's already in progress so that there's a little bit of scaffolding already. Like a lot of the newer work that's happened in programming languages for networks over the last few years has been able to build on some of the scaffolding that we and others have helped create. And it makes it easier for people to join in without having to sort of fight the battles that we did at the beginning. Of course, there's risk if you join too late that the problem is stale. So it's a tricky business to sort of rely on an existing community. But if done right, that can be quite effective. Another concern I often hear from people is managing risk. When you have publications in multiple fields, we published in programming languages and in networking, or in optimization venues and in networking, that can certainly be an issue. There's often many authors, many faculty authors, and papers that are split over different kinds of venues, which can be a very diffuse notion of who actually should be getting credit for the work. Again, something that affects junior people more than senior. And so what we've done historically is to favor the publication venues that are important for the junior author. So for example, when I worked with Meng at Princeton, he wasn't tenured yet. When I worked with Nate, he was not tenured yet. And so we tended, whenever we had to make a choice, to pick the venue that was most important for their careers, because it really didn't matter much to me if we published an extra paper in one of my conferences or not, but it did matter a lot for them. Another thing is to really understand the institution's evaluation process. Are they going to value interdisciplinary work? Are they going to value work with multiple faculty authors, or are they going to discount it completely? And that distinction obviously matters a lot. A school that does a sensible evaluation criteria will look at letters from experts in the field and not be so preoccupied with how many authors are on a paper. But some schools are not like that, and it's obviously important to know that. And I should just say, having worked in both interdisciplinary projects with other colleagues and worked on intradisciplinary projects with other colleagues, one advantage of interdisciplinary work is it's often really obvious whose fingerprints are on which parts of the work. When I work with Meng on optimization, it's clear that the mathematical solutions come from him and that the mathematical framing comes at least in part from me. Whereas if it were two people, both from networking or both from optimization, it'd be much more murky to tell where the intellectual contributions were actually coming from. Finally, I'd just say, healthy interdisciplinary collaborations. I've had a lot of projects that started off exciting and then never really came to fruition. And a big part of why that happened was that people just don't stay engaged. We're all busy. It's really hard to get airtime with one another. And you want people that stay engaged and actually really intellectually dig in for the heavy lifting of understanding the problem space. And for that to happen, not only do you have to deal with the fact that people are busy, but the work has to be exciting in the other person's field. It might be that there's some area of theoretical computer science that's really useful to networking, so I'd be excited about it, but the theoretician might not be because it's just old hat for them. It might not be intellectually all that rich a space if it doesn't push the discipline forward. And so that can be a challenge, and some projects will just fall apart on that alone. Similar value structures can be quite challenging to have. Some fields like networking really value having running code, prototypes, measurement data, graphs. Other disciplines sometimes prefer proofs. theorems and so on. And if both matter, both faculty members involved really have to value that both might exist in the same paper or in the same project. If there's not a sort of shared view that the union of the two sets of value structures are shared, it can be really hard to make the work happen. Obviously, engaging students and postdocs in the project is hugely important as well, because none of these projects move forward based solely on the faculty members. And finally, I know this is not a trendy thing to say, and as someone who works on the internet, you would think collaborating remotely would be very reasonable to me, but actually I find working with people on this kind of work particularly in person is just so critical. All three projects I mentioned were with people in New Jersey, two of them in Princeton and one at Rutgers, you know, 20 minutes away. Really, that's key because this kind of work involves a lot of confusing conversations about grappling with each other's terminology and ideas, and it's just super, super difficult to do that on Skype or Google Hangouts. So I'm a plug there for people to actually work with local collaborators. It's actually really important. The interdisciplinary projects I started that were remote almost always failed. Just to end, computer networking, I think, is a hugely exciting area with tremendous opportunity for real-world impact, an intellectually rich space of problems, and a true grand challenge for all of computer science, really, not just for networking, to build networks that are truly worthy of the trust our society increasingly places in them. And I think that's really possible if we can find big problems to work on together that reach across the substantial intellectual divides that exist between different parts of our field. And I'd be happy to take questions.
Hi, I really enjoy your talk, and I'm not in this field at all, but it's very inspiring. And I want to, so you introduce your experiences. You start at AT&T for many years and then switch. I want to know how that relate to the way of you think after you move from this industry to the academia. And also, I kind of want to do the same thing. So I'm a researcher at a company. I benefit a lot, but eventually I hope I can contribute to the academia. I want to know if what's the good thing and also the bad thing when we do this transition.
Yeah, that's a great question. My time at AT&T had a really profound effect on the research style I have now, in part because at AT&T we were definitely problem-driven, and so we would grab whatever people we needed to solve a problem. And I found people in theoretical areas of computer science very willing to work together because that was part of their mission too. They were at an industrial lab because they wanted to do that style of work. Whereas in an academic setting, a lot of people have very different goals, and it can be actually harder to find like-minded people. Also, access to network administrators and places to tech transfer my ideas also made that kind of work uniquely exciting. So it was a place that I had an unfair advantage over my academic peers for doing that kind of research, and also it was a place I could really find collaborators. So I think trying to transfer that type of work over to Princeton was, I think, a rocky start for me at the beginning because incentives for faculty are different than in industry, but I've been, you know, so far finding some success in doing that, and I think that was possible because I already sort of naturally worked that way, but more challenging because I have to work with other people who don't naturally do so. For me, the time I spent at AT&T was amazing. I mean, I learned so much that I would never have been able to learn, I think, in an academic setting. So for me, the ways I think in terms of navigating a transition, I worked a lot with interns. When I negotiated my job at AT&T, I didn't negotiate on salary, I negotiated on summer interns and people understanding I wanted to be on program committees. So basically, I negotiated on make it possible for me to have an external presence in the research community. That was the first and only thing that mattered to me, and I was very aggressive on that and completely non-aggressive on everything else. That might have been unwise in other ways, and certainly it made my salary lower, but so I'm not saying you have to do that, but that was the thing that mattered to me, and I wanted that to be super clear. I tried to keep long-term relationships with students. That the 10 to 12 week internship cycle is not enough to get a real problem solved. And fortunately, we had unique access to data and other technology that made it possible for students that worked with us to want to continue the relationship. So that certainly helped quite a lot in making it possible to make the transition. But I tried very hard to work with students, sometimes write grant proposals with faculty to keep them engaged in the project, be on program committees, do tutorials, to try to make the community aware of the kind of problems I was interested in, because the academic community wasn't always fully aligned with the same set of problems that I was interested in working on. Yeah, thanks for asking that.
Hey, I really enjoyed your talk, and I was doing my research in Georgia Tech, and the kind of problems I faced was, like, in your presentation, you mentioned that choose your hammer wisely. How do you choose your hammer wisely? Like, I had no idea, like, what topic to choose. Everything sounded interesting, but how do you know which research would work? How do you know how deep you should go before you know that now it's time to get out? Maybe this is not giving you results. And, like, so how, like, I can rely on my mentor, but as for myself, like, what else should I rely on? And how should I choose my hammer, basically?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think in my own field in networking, a lot of the questions we ask are resource allocation questions. And so if you think about the kind of problems we're always asking, what's common across a lot of literature in the field? In networking, it's often resource allocation. Packet scheduling, routing, congestion control, they're all resource allocation questions. And so that naturally makes you think of optimization theory, control theory. So that helped in sort of thinking about the problems. For me, I'm also, you know, thinking about who your user is. Most people, I think of the end user, you know, that's connected to the internet as their user. I think of the network operator as my user, because I spent 8 years seeing them suffer, you know, trying to keep the internet up with baling wire and duct tape. And so I think, what is the pain? Who's experiencing pain? And what do I need to do to alleviate their pain? And so that sort of connection with the human user, in this case, the network operator, I think informed for me that language issues, you know, what are the languages they're using to configure the network? And that's what led me to be interested in programming languages. So I think some of it's born out of what are a broad class of problems in your field fall under, and what are the pain points that either industry or human users are suffering? I think those are, I think, the main things, at least in my experience, that helped.
My name is Lena Battistelli, NC State. I have a question on your vision of software-defined networking. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned that it definitely has application in the data center or the access or the edge of the network. Do you see that having impact maybe more toward the core or even changing some of these standard protocols that are around and kind of very difficult to change? Because they may glue everything together?
Yeah, that's a great question. The early adopters of SDN have largely been the large cloud providers, or Google, Facebook, Microsoft, and so on, you know, in their private backbone networks, so in that case, in the core, but admittedly in private networks that are interconnecting their data centers, or in data centers. And part of that is that they were doing a tremendous build of new networking and finding the existing equipment very ill-suited and overpriced for their needs. So I think they were sort of a very natural, people who know how to write code, who are doing a tremendous networking spend with equipment that didn't meet their needs, so that was a perfect storm. The next wave of adopters include large enterprises and internet service providers, you know, like AT&T or large financial firms, because they also have tremendous IT spend. It's a little more challenging there because they tend to have less software expertise, and they often have legacy equipment that they can't get rid of until, you know, many years out. So that's been a little bit of a slower step of adoption, but it's certainly starting to get some headway. Internet exchange points are in the core, I think, an interesting place where lots of providers meet at one location, where a person running an exchange point could add value-added services just at those juncture points in the internet, just by a small deployment of new equipment and services. So I think that's been another interesting opportunity. And these days, a lot of people are interested in also cellular networks as another place to deploy more programmability, because a lot of, obviously, a lot, tremendous investments going into cellular access networks that can benefit from new technology. So I do think it can be more wide in its adoption, but I think we're seeing a gradual evolution from the data center to private backbones to public backbones to internet exchange points, and then gradually towards the other parts of the access edge, just because of the adoption challenges.
Hi, this is Madhvi from Citigroup, and thank you for a very informative session. I have a heavy programming background, and recently I'm doing SDN. So I was wondering, you had talked about Knox using for the SDN app development. Is that, how popular is that, and could you?
Oh yeah, good question. I use that as an example of some very early technology that when we first started our programming languages project, we took the only SDN controller that was really available open source at the time and built our applications on top of that. As just to learn from the pain of doing that. And so Knox is not active anymore. It was just something that we used as an early starting point for our work. So the creation of Knox and of OpenFlow was hugely helpful to us. But nowadays, I think people mostly use ONOS or Open Daylight as, you know, the two main controller platforms. Was that your question? Or
Yeah, that partly answers my question, and I was wondering what recommendations you have. I mean, do you have any preference of the programming language to do the SDN?
Yeah, so the language we developed called Frenetic, I think, has had some influence on these platforms, but I think the choice of Open Daylight versus ONAS is really one related to how much legacy equipment is in the network, because I think ONAS is cleaner and conceptually nicer, but it doesn't interact with as wide a range of legacy equipment as Open Daylight. And so I think that tends to be the fork in the road for most people. And then there's starting to be a lot of interest in P4, this programming language for the data plane. It's being their products now from Barefoot Networks, from Xilinx, from Netronome, deployments in various companies now. So I'm actually really excited about that as well, because I think it significantly increases the number of applications that can be efficiently supported in the network.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Hi, I have a very quick question about what I understood about the open flow is open source API. Do you happen to know any industry currently using them? I mean, how popular is it?
So OpenFlow has been used in Google's deployment. So Google has some very nice papers on their B4 backbone that uses mm-hmm. OpenFlow. There's also been deployments in a lot of other, like telecoms in China as well. And a number of different projects, like a couple of companies like Big Switch Networks that uses OpenFlow to do a variety of network monitoring and security applications. So I think it's seen reasonably wide deployment. I think this sort of middle stage of getting large carriers to adopt has been more tricky because of the constraints of the legacy equipment and the difficulty of doing a sort of greenfield deployment. So it does seem like so far that the P4 is at a much earlier stage than OpenFlow. It's only a few years old, whereas OpenFlow is 10 years old. It seems to be getting adoption much more quickly. It's used extensively inside Cisco. It's used extensively at Google.
Okay.
And there's starting to be a number of applications running. There was a demo on AT&T's network recently as well. So I think it's enjoying quicker adoption, at least so far. It could just be that it's on the front edge of its curve. So I don't know if that's, you know, it's hard to predict the future, but that seems to be enjoying faster adoption.
Thank you.
Hi, Ramya from IBM Research. Thanks for the talk. This kind of summarizes the experiences I've been having personally over the last year or so publishing papers in interdisciplinary fields. So one of the problems we're facing is figuring out where to publish. There's a nail and a hammer in which community really wants to see these kind of papers. And there has been pushback in, you know, each community saying this is not deep work in this community. Maybe, you know, you want to publish it in someplace else. So how have you had any similar experiences finding acceptance in these communities? And how do you actually decide where this work belongs? What community?
Yeah, that's great. I remember the second paper we sent to a programming languages conference on the PL project, we had a review say, hey, there's already been one paper on programming languages meets networking, so like, aren't we done? And I was like, oh no. This is bad. So some of that we grapple with, you know, I gave a keynote at one of the PL conferences. We created a workshop called Hot Topics in Software-Defined Networking, which became a conference symposium on SDN research. So we tried to create venues for like-minded people to meet and to be able to publish their work. And I think that helped in building up the community so that they could publish in what might be a second-tier venue compared to what their main objective might be to publish at their main home conferences, but at least allowed an outlet for their work and an opportunity for the community to congeal together. So I think creating venues is hugely important. And the summer schools that we did and tutorials, I think, helped as well in making that happen. The optimization work I found harder and because I think the networking community can sometimes be sort of math phobic. And so although the math in those papers were not super hard, there was enough that people were like, ooh, I don't know, there's Greek, you know. And in the optimization community, because we tried to make the problems easy enough to solve by making the network better, the math wasn't interesting. Right, so we had this weird irony that the networking conferences thought the math was too hard, and the more mathematical conferences thought the math was too easy. And like, okay, what are you going to do? And we never quite figured out how to nail that question, if you will. Yeah.
Good question. I'm Jenny Gong from Qualcomm. So from your talk, you mentioned it's very important to collaborate with the experts in different domains and get them engaged. I just want to know, do you have any advice how to make them engage? Do you set milestone? Or how do you get, since they're very busy, right, in their expert area? So
That's a really good question. I think definitely spending a lot of time brainstorming to figure out if there's a there. I mean, a lot of these projects aren't intellectually interesting on both sides. So having, and sometimes those meetings can take place in the context of writing a grant proposal. I mean, one thing, I mean, a lot of faculty complain about writing grant proposals, but they're good for two reasons. I think one is, you know, thinking ahead about what you're gonna do is actually a useful thing to do. And when there's a grant proposal deadline, even faculty members who are tremendously busy will find a way to find the time. Because if you don't, you can't support your group. So the sort of, ironically, the forcing function of having a grant proposal deadline sitting in front of you will often be the forcing function to have people spend serious time together and then figure out if they actually really want to do the work together.
Hi, Jen, Allison Mencken.
Hey.
Hi, nice
to see you.
Now at Salesforce, but also chairing the Internet Research Task Force. And one of the things that we're quite interested in doing is figuring out a way to support interdisciplinary research publication. And I wondered if people have tried to do like an open access journal that was specifically for interdisciplinary, maybe guided by the goals of network and security researchers, since that's what we are, but with, you know, invitations to everybody. Is that something that you've heard about at all? And do you think there would be appetite for that?
That's a nice idea. And I think also the IRTF's, you know, research, Applied Networking Research Prize, has been a really great innovation, I think, because it's nice to recognize that work that goes the extra mile to be faithful to reality. And the internet's complicated, right? And so people that go that extra mile, that work isn't always as respected as it should be by the rest of the academic community. And so it's nice to, I've seen a number of people get validated that way. And I think especially for students who sometimes struggle to get those papers in, it's a wonderful recognition for them. So I think, I don't know if a separate publication venue is the right one, because there is a risk of ghettoizing the work also, but I can see the value, particularly for a journal version of the work where you might want to put the full details that sometimes don't get left out when you're tailoring the paper towards one venue or the other. But I think more awards that recognize, you know, work that really does bridge the gap is another way to help validate students who are investing energy, and junior faculty too, who are investing.
I'm going to give a shameless plug. We've just put out the call for papers for the Applied Networking Research Prize, and it's $1,000 plus travel to give the paper in the IRTF IETF meetings. So if you have published a paper in the last year that you like and think has a good applied networking or an applied security topic, please send it to us. Look for this call for papers. Thank you. Thanks for giving me that chance, Jen.
No problem. Other questions? There's someone in the back there.
Thanks, that was a great talk. I'm curious about the first problem you talked about, where you have multiple utility functions and you're trying to optimize for them. And I'm curious what you think about the fact that now we can actually learn about traffic patterns, we can learn about utility functions. Do you think this is implementable in the short term in hardware, or there's challenges going to make it quite far out for us to be able to actually achieve the gains from machine learning within the networking community?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. It's funny you mentioned this. The last class I had in my networking class before coming here was exactly on learnability of congestion control. There are a number of exciting papers in that area where instead of, you know, kind of moving around in the dark trying to figure out how to design the next version of congestion control, can't we actually have the sender do experiments? Send at a particular rate, see what utility they get, send at another rate, see what utility they get, and make decisions about which way to go just based on learning. I think it's a very exciting area. A second is these programmable switches, although they're very limited, they should be able to do some of the early steps of the measurements one might want to do to drive a learning algorithm. And so I'm very interested in figuring out to what extent some of the analytics that would go into a learning algorithm might be implementable, at least in part, in the switch, even if you can't implement everything there. And I think that's a really unexplored area that would be quite interesting.
Hi, Maria, it's Zurich. I wanted to ask you something about priorities that you had in your talk. So basically, it's good that if we could deal with packets in the network based on what priority they are in. But who defines priority? Because it's like many people are talking about it, but I don't really understand. Since developers are not willing to define the priority, I think. And usually the traffic is not classified. So how do you deal with it if you're in the middle of the network?
Right, and I think that's part of the reason that that hasn't tended to happen in practice if you're a large core network, like let's say like a transit network like AT&T, but if you're a private backbone, like say Google or Microsoft have, then often they're carrying their own traffic and they have a lot of awareness from the edge of whether something is a background process to send, let's say, search indices once a day to other data centers as opposed to something that's involved in the handling of a user request. And so I think in that setting, that's what makes the cloud really interesting to networking people. You have the same party having control over the network, the servers, and in some cases, even the app, where there is an opportunity to cross layers and actually pass that information around.
I understand like you can do it in the data center, like because you basically own all the traffic and you're responsible for also classifying it. But what about like the internet in general, or is it currently a way of doing that?
I think it's harder in an end-to-end setting to do that, but I think the cloud is getting closer to the edge in the sense that a lot of these large cloud providers have data centers, private backbones, edge servers, and the path between the edge server and the client can often be quite short, where a lot of the optimization is taking place in the path before you actually get there. That doesn't fully answer your question. I mean, there is a sort of last, end miles, if you will, that it's harder to do traffic differentiation. But certainly possible in another setting where it's an enterprise customer with a virtual private network connected to the cloud, where you have some hope of a combined virtual private network and cloud service. And certainly some companies do offer that. But I think the sort of general end user running an app, it's a lot more difficult unless the network provider can say, oh, I think this is Netflix, or I think this is not. They sometimes can do application inference inside the network, but they are having to infer things that are known elsewhere because it's not explicitly tagged in the packet.
Thank you.
You bet.
I'm currently shopping for master's programs, and I was just curious if you have a book or a class that you'd recommend for, like, other than TCP/IP network administration through Craig Hunt.
In terms of books on networking, you mean? Or?
Yeah.
So there's a book by Jim Karos and Keith Ross, Computer Networking, a sort of top-down approach, that I think is quite nice. It's a particularly nice book if you're learning on your own because it's extremely readable with really good examples, and so I would highly recommend that one.
Okay, great.
And there's also my colleague Nick Feimster at Princeton. If you search Nick Feimster on Google, he has all of the lectures from our networking classes online, as well as a Coursera course on software-defined networking, whose videos are online as well. So if you look for Nick Feimster, F-E-A-M-S-T-E-R, on YouTube, you'll see both his software-defined networking class and his undergrad networking class as video lectures.
Can you say the first book again?
Feimster, F-E-A-M-S-T-E-R. If you can't find it, just drop me an email. I'm jrex at Princeton.
All right, thank you.
You bet. Okay, thank you.